One of the first things I wanted to do in this session was to thank Sarah Rubenfeld and Laura Sangella, who did all the organization, and they just walked out of the room. So when they come back in, oh, there's Sarah. And Laura's walked out. But they did a great job doing all the organization, arranging all the invitations and things, and so I'm indebted to them. Also to Jeff Goldsmith, who you'll see later this afternoon. He co-chaired our planning committee. We had our planning committee members. We also had at Columbia Mailman School of Public Health, we have a data science faculty advisory committee that also helped a lot with these arrangements and organizations, so thanks to all of them. And hopefully everyone figured out how to use these rocket books. So like I saw some people really confused by this, but the idea is that, you know, these are cleanable, you can reuse them, but there's a QR code, you scan it, and you can not use paper anymore. It's really a great thing. So one of the things we did in starting this was we wanted to have this broad inclusion of the schools and programs in public health. And we have a great turnout from that. But we thought it would be especially nice if the person who runs the show, Laura, the CEO and president of ASPPH, could say a few words. So with that, Laura.
Thank you very much. It's truly a great honor to be here representing all the schools of public health and programs. And as an educator, because I am an educator myself, I'm really delighted to be just engaging with all of you, our academic community, in this dialogue. I think that ASPPH is always supporting the competency-based education, and as such, it's our obligation to really always keep an eye on assessing really what's going on in the field in order to bring to our schools and programs, our systems, what's going on there, in order to be just changing accordingly. And sometimes it just seems that we're not good at that. I mean, the changes that we made in our curriculums, sometimes it really spends so much time just in doing that. So sometimes it feels like we are training our students for a world that doesn't really exist, because all the skills that they need and the competencies are not in our curriculums yet. So I think that in this field, the data science is not about if we're gonna do it or not. It's a matter of how are we gonna start doing that, or who are doing it right now, and we need to learn and to share what's going on. So there's a lot of, we have, I think, more questions than answers. So we still need to figure out, like, what are the key basic skills and competencies that all our professionals, all our public health professionals need to have in this area, and how do we embed those competencies in the curriculum, which we already have, right? But we also want to know what are the competencies, more specialized competencies for the people, for the graduates that really want to devote all their work in this area. So are there new degrees? Are there gonna be new areas of concentrations? Are there gonna be new credentials? What happened with the workforce that they need right now, already these competencies? What are we doing with them? There are some models out there. So that's exactly the panel discussion right now. So I'm very excited about that, because it's just like we want to know what's going on and how can we support the development of this area in our curriculum. So I'm really, I congratulate all of you. This effort is incredible. It will be really very important for all the job that we do, and hopefully we can keep on transforming the way we are teaching our students, and hopefully we also want to impact our competencies and our models of accreditation when we have all this dialogue among ourselves. So thank you very much. I'm looking forward for the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. You're cutting into my time now.
I had to advance the slide. hand that over to you. And also, on the IO app, there's a last section for next steps in that last session. If there's things you think we should be doing in the future, please make those suggestions now so we have those ideas archived for future things. You can add to them as we go through. So there you go.
All right. So, hi everybody. Can everybody hear me? My mic is good? Okay, excellent. Thank you, Laura, for that introduction. I'm gonna introduce our panelists. I think we had a really nice session and engaging and interactive session prior to lunch, and I'm really excited to help moderate that discussion. I know These conversations about what we are doing in data science education throughout our schools and programs is on everybody's minds, particularly those sitting in the room. It's a conversation we have all the time at Mailman in terms of challenging ourselves and what is it that we want every single student to know when they walk in the door, and what is it that we want our leading edge scientists to know, and everything in between for those students that walk into our programs. So this is a really, I think, exciting and critical time to be asking these questions. So I'm going to introduce the panelists. We have the opportunity for you all to submit questions throughout and ask questions afterwards, and we'll hopefully have a really thoughtful dialogue about what are the kinds of challenges that we're all facing and thinking about. How do those build into opportunities, ideas, and examples of how we operationalize and actualize what we intend to do. So I'm going to turn things over to my esteemed panel and briefly introduce themselves, although I think many of you know them. My newest colleague here at Columbia, and that's Dr. Kiros Berhane, who many of you already know and has joined us as the chair of Biostatistics. We have Dr. Stephanie Hicks, who's the assistant professor at Johns Hopkins, Bloomberg School of Public Health, and Dr. Bhramar Mukherjee, who's the chair of Biostatistics at the University of Michigan. So thank you all for joining us, and we're going to go this way. And Kiros, I'm going to turn things over to you first.
Thank you very much, and hi, everyone, again. I think, you know, it's really appropriate that I actually be part of this panel out of the three, because before I came to Columbia, I spent a number of years directing graduate programs at the University of Southern California. And one of the things that we grappled with a couple of years ago was actually what to do about data science. And most partly, actually, the reason was the students were well ahead of us. Even though we were training them in biostatistics, they were already taking matters into their hands, and they were taking courses from computer science or from other venues, or taking boot camps, and they were finding jobs at, you know, data science-oriented, you know, settings. So we felt that actually probably we were doing a disservice, you know, by not going enough with the times, but also by not giving them the right level of competency, especially when they come from biostatistical and biomedical type contexts. So we started to think about those issues, and my comments are gonna be mainly focusing on the doctoral programs, even though I'm going to start with some issues that we are all grappling with, regardless at what level, you know, of training we're talking about. So one issue is when you talk about public health data science, what is the nature of the training? So we know that there is lots of similarities with typical computer science-oriented, you know, data science programs, mainly focusing on artificial intelligence and deep learning and other things, but mainly focusing on prediction and other, you know, areas that may or may not be directly relevant to public health research. So, but we have to recognize that there are lots of similarities in core competency with computer science-based programs. So whatever we develop has to have that in mind. And then, attention to core biostatistical principles that are still of great interest and of great value, as Rob and many others have mentioned. As statisticians, we are trying to be principled, to think about the design, to think about what, you know, we end up with at the end of the day. And in computer science and in artificial intelligence, that may not be the core goal. So, but for biomedical research, those are actually very, very important elements. So when we train students, we actually have to take those issues into mind as well. Attention to biomedical and public health focus, especially the need for understanding the so-called black box that Rob talked about, especially in neural network setting, in domain knowledge context. Again, our training has to really make, you know, students capable of thinking along those lines. The other issue that we grappled was the level of training, right? Do we really give courses within existing programs so that our students have the right competency? Or do we have standalone programs like certificate or tracks within existing degrees or standalone degrees, whether it's a master's or a PhD level degree? And then the other issue is training, but to what end? What exactly are we training them for? And this actually brings us to the training that happens not only in typical biostatistics departments, but also other departments within a school of public health or medical setting. Like a student in environmental health or a student in epidemiology or sociomedical sciences, what kind of data science competency do they need to have and at what level? So it's not only like the core technical kind of, you know, settings, but it's really, you know, the whole spectrum of training that we have to think about. And then the final issue, which I think the next panel is going to talk about, is the ethical issues that come with data science training. How do we really, you know, make students capable when they go out for, you know, with their degrees to really be ethical in their practice, and how do they go about it? And of course, we heard today that there were lots of, thoughts along those lines, whether it's really important, and if it's important, in what way we deal with them. So I'm not going to go to belabor that kind of discussion, because it has its own panel. So in the remaining time, what I'm going to do is actually to probably give you two examples. One is what's being done at Columbia, to the extent that I understand it. Mm-hmm. Remind you, you know, I have only been here for 2 weeks, but, you know, I have studied the educational programs. But, you know, Columbia has taught a lot about how to, you know, put data science into the current curriculum. In fact, I think a couple of years ago, there was an overhaul of the curriculum. And what I'm going to show you, a couple of slides that I stole from Jeff, who was overseeing, you know, at least helping to oversee the program, how to inculcate, you know, data science issues into the current PhD program. So what was done at Columbia was there was a launch of two-semester data science sequence in 2017 in order to address a gap in the MS training for biostatistics students. That has implications for PhD later on, because a lot of the master's students actually will go on to do a PhD in data science or other fields. So two courses were presented or developed. One is Data Science 1, and it focused on tools, basically version control, reproducibility, data management, manipulation, graphics, and web scraping, and so on and so forth, which, you know, actually things that we talked about already. The second part of the sequence focused on methods, things like the lasso, ridge regression, principal component analysis, clustering, and so on and so forth. And then classes were designed to be complement to other training in epidemiology, statistical inference, and traditional methods in biostatistics. So this is a perfect example how an existing PhD program could actually be modified in order to address the needs for data science. In the Data Science 1 expanded to meet demand from MPH and non-biostat MS students as well. So this touched into the competency that would be required for other students in other programs. Okay? So that was kind of, you know, what the modifications were, to the data science courses, for at least to not fill the gap in the MS programs. Now, when it comes to doctoral training, then doctoral students do take the same sequence, but this is if they haven't learned it already. But they're also required to have advanced training statistical learning methods, like similar topics to data science too, but at a more theoretical and more fundamental level. So this is, you know, basically, you know, to really equip them with the right level of tools in order to practice as data scientists as needed. And other training from biostatistics, you know, there was a course developed very recently, actually, Intro to Health Data Science, that is really non-technical but supposed to give competency to students, you know, so that they have enough knowledge in data science. Okay, so that's one example how an existing program, a doctoral program, could actually be, you know, enhanced in order to incorporate data science components. The flip side of that is, of course, to develop a full-fledged data science PhD program. Are we ready for that? I think that's a question for everyone. In fact, at ESC, when we were talking about the, you know, data science programs, we decided at the end, after a long discussion, that the right place to start is actually a master's in data science, and especially with focus in biomedical research and health, you know, public health kind of research techniques. So I think, you know, my colleagues actually are going to talk about MS programs, so I'm not going to go a lot about that. In fact, I only have like 1 minute left. But I just want to give you an example of what was done at USC where I was. A group of us actually worked very hard in order to come up with a curriculum that would form an MS in health data science, so that, you know, all the principles that I talked about actually were respected. In fact, one of my colleagues, Meredith Franklin, is actually sitting in the audience today, and she's directing this program that I'm going to talk about. So the MS in public health program actually had several components in the training, either to prepare students for PhD program later on, if there is one, or to make them ready for the workforce. And, you know, the design was actually basically to be able to do all, you know, both angles. So the curriculum had 32 required units, It included foundation courses, like Introduction to Health Data Sciences, core courses, and this actually included biostatistics and public health core that any MS in biostatistics student will take, and then computer science core. And these courses were actually supposed to be taken from the computer science department. In fact, we really wanted to partner because there are, you know, competencies that would be better served or better learned for either from a computer science department or from a department of statistics or biostatistics that has the right level of people in order to teach those kind of skills. And then a bunch of elective courses that would actually take the student in any direction that they need to go to. So I think that kind of level of training right now is needed, and a lot of programs are doing it, but I think that would be the stepping stone to having full-fledged PhD programs, which is why I want to talk about it in my panel discussion as well. So with that, I think I'm out of time.
Yes, sir. You hand down the line, there you go. Thank you.
So thank you, can everybody hear me? All right. So first of all, I'd like to congratulate Gary and Dean Fried and Columbia for starting this movement, and all the representatives from peer schools of public health who are here this afternoon. This is the room where it happens. So I really feel in a celebratory mood to celebrate all that we have accomplished as public health scientists and data scientists. But I'm also feeling a little bit of a revolutionary mood that I want to burn down the system. So I really, there are things that are not working, and we just say that this is not working, this is the incentive, this is the what we are used to, but why we are actually have created the system, so we should be able to change it too. So in Michigan, I have been chair for 18 months now, and this is the midpoint of my chair term, and I always have this question. Our department started in 1949, and the statistics department started in 1969. So here is an example where the biostatistics department is older than the statistics department by 20 years, and much more profound in knowledge. But we are always facing this question, me and my colleague Zhuming He, the chair of the statistics department, that are you going to change the name of the department to biostatistics and data science and statistics and data science? So my first response is that then our acronyms will be SADS and BADS, and you really do not want SADS and BADS lurking on campus. But I think I have an improved response to this. And like John Quackenbush, I like to have quotes as well. And instead of my own quotes, I differ from John in that respect. I actually like quotes by very strong and profound female pioneering statisticians. So and there are some of them, and so I would like to reflect upon Gertrude Cox, a pioneering female statistician who was strongly committed to excellence in data science and computation even in the 1950s. So I'd like to draw upon this quote from a paper in JASA in 1957, 63 years ago now, and it says that this tension about data and science really continuously bypassing what we have in statistics. So, if 10 years ago we had predicted some of the things we are doing today, we'd have been ridiculed. And so this is now my concern, is that we may be too conservative in our thinking. And those of you who have not read this paper, this was actually a beautiful paper where she explains the statistical universe as some established continents and then some unexplored islands that we are about to embark on. And sometimes you traverse this universe as an explorer and sometimes as a tourist. And sometimes we worry if we have the right immigration status to explore an island or go to a country. So the established continents are descriptive statistics and exploratory analysis, experimental design, and then theory and analysis. So this quote sort of gave me shivers. My PhD is in statistics in 2001 from Purdue University, and I feel my training is antediluvian. And what I see in my desktop every day, 80,000 patients from Michigan Medicine with electronic health records and 21 million genes, this is a fairy tale. But I think that this is a data-driven fairy tale. So my flight was late last night, so I do not follow that you actually assented to a working definition of data science. So I proceeded to create something because sort of prompts the educational initiatives that we have launched in Michigan. And so because every scientist sort of has a lens through which they see the world, and my own work has always been in adaptive estimation and shrinkage estimation. So obviously I wanted to apply that framework. So I define data science, inadequately so, as weighted combination of statistics and computer science. And the problem is that the weight goes to zero in some computer science departments, and W goes to one in some stat biostat departments. Right. And basically, when I give a talk, I data adaptively choose W to please the crowd so that I don't get killed. And then also on the problem that I'm trying to solve, which one I'm going to leaning towards, more machine learning or more inferential tools. So I'll show you some data that data science has definitely injected a shock to our system, to our old classical system. And this is flawed data, because these are Google Trends, which you know are fundamentally flawed, who is searching for terms. And so this is the search comparing statistician versus data scientist versus computer scientist. So if you look at the trend lines, you'll see that the red line is the search for data scientist, the yellow line is computer scientist, and the blue line is statistician. So regardless of the biases influencing this data, there cannot be any question probably that there has been a change. And since 2014 onwards, that time period, people have been searching for the job title data scientist quite a bit. It is still reassuring to see over time that the blue line has consistently stayed over the yellow line. So this tension between computer scientists and data scientists and how we train the next generation of statisticians and biostatisticians leads us to think about, when we are thinking about our teaching programs, that what do we want ourselves to be? The popular image as a statistician. So are we a doer or a thinker? And the identity crisis of a statistician, I'd sort of like to draw a parallel to this movie, Imitation Game. Alan Turing and Jack Good are two famous quantitative scientists, and Benedict Cumberbatch obviously stole the show as a computer scientist cracking the German naval code. And this has arguably reduced the duration of the World War II by two or more years, saving millions of lives. There was a statistician in that team, Jack Good, who is actually a highly influential figure in Bayesian revival, but was portrayed very quietly in the movie. He was in the background doing optimal likelihood calculation so that the Germans do not find out that they have actually cracked the code. So there was a lot of angst about this portrayal of statisticians, and David Banks wrote this angry email that this is a misrepresentation of his career, of his contribution and his character. But talking to ourselves does not help. So as we are really thinking about creating the 21st century statistician, three skill sets that we are focusing on, along with our mathematical statistics skills, are communication, collaboration, and computation. These three skills we think are extremely important. And as we talk about collaboration, there's an obvious modification to the definition that I just posed, that we definitely want to incorporate domain science. And I still actually choose to stay in the shrinkage framework because that's what I do. And so in Michigan, we recently launched the health data science concentration in our master's in biostatistics program. This is an ensemble of courses which focuses on computation in both Python and R, followed by statistical issues in data science, machine learning, reproducibility, open science, and scientific rigor, choices of sampling and design, and causal inference. And in order to support this, the department has actually really, if you go to the Michigan website now, you'll see all the software that faculty have produced. You can search software by domain and by faculty. And we have hired full-time computer scientists who are actually supporting software and hardware needs of this problem for this program, as well as a full-time R package developer service supporting our students. So as we thought about the program, we also want to think about the job market. So our students are going to Facebook, Amazon, Google, 23andMe, where prediction is actually one of the tasks. But in our curriculum, we'd like to argue that clicking where are you going to click next and I'm going to make most of the money is not the primary focus of a school of public health or a school of medicine. We can predict things very well without knowing the mechanism or the causality or why we are able to predict and what is influencing these behaviors. So I do not think that everything will be reduced to algorithmic prediction. I believe that sampling, design, and this has been reiterated over and over since morning, that what is the fundamental stat 101 question, who is in my study, what is the target population of inference, is actually definitely going to be important. Principal data integration, when data is coming from different sources, missing data, property treatment of missing data, causality, fundamentals of public health in terms of generalizability, transportability, representativeness, and incorporating the scientific context is something we are really focusing on. And this program also has immersive case studies in electronic health records, imaging on genetics, so that students actually do case studies in big data. So I just want to come back and say that in order to really experiment with ourselves, and let us really be a little playful and artful with like dangerous data science, what Gertrude Cox in the same paper said, that with our scientific backgrounds, there is no reason why we should be so cautious and careful that we cannot really play a little bit with ourselves and the way we are teaching our students. And it is important to really explore the underdeveloped and the unexplored, or even the dangerous areas. And I think I want to be a little dangerous with data science. And as soon as we think that we have come closer to the truth, the horizon moves farther away, so it would be a continuously evolving process. So for new horizons, I think you need new voyages. And the best thing that I have done in my entire career, and I'm pretty confident that this is the best thing that I'd have ever have done, is actually to start this undergraduate summer program in big data. When you do not know what data science and big data means, you start a program to teach yourself and to teach and actually learn mentoring up was mentioned. These undergraduate students, fearless undergraduate students, she taught me so much about big data. In the last 5 years, we have trained 203 students, and you can look at the program. All our material is available on the wiki site. And this program has taught me that, yes, certainly I'm a data dreamer, but I'm not the only one. So I think this has been mentioned many, many times, that we are rewriting the narrative of data science. I have negative time left. And as different institutes are launching these data science initiatives, and there is always comment, who is at the helm of this initiative? Is it a computer scientist? Is it a biostatistician? Is it a statistician? Who is going to win the big data prize or get more resources from the university to do data science? How is data science being branded as from School of Engineering, School of Public Health, College of Liberal Arts and Sciences? I'd really like to say that be in education, be in society, be in polity, union of different cultures is the best approach to solving a scientific problem. So these are some books, Causal Inference, The Book of Why, Once Upon an Algorithm, Artificial Intelligence, Basic Probability. And if we are writing the postmodernist actually narrative of statistics and public health and data science, let us really decry and really distrust all these theories, grandiose theories, and let us really burn the system down and change our admission, change our qualifiers, and reward excellence in every domain of quantitative science. So thank you very much.
Well, the revolution begins here. You heard it. Please, Stephanie, and then we'll go on.
Wow, I am not sure I'm going to be able to follow that, but I will give it a shot. Okay, so I thought I would begin by telling you a little bit about myself. I'm an assistant professor. I'm not as well known as these two here, so I thought I would just spend 1 minute on that. So I did my bachelor's in mathematics, PhD in statistics, went on to do a postdoc in Boston with Rafael Irizarry, and then I most recently joined Hopkins 2 years ago. Broad interests are in statistics, genomics, public health, and data science. And if you'll notice there, that is my new doppelganger, Puppet Stephanie, who's currently going to be used in children's videos to teach children about data science in the Hopkins Data Science Lab. I'm really excited about that. Okay, Houston, we have a data science problem. So this is a cool graphic that I found on the web showing you data science job postings and searches. So postings in purple, searches in blue. So postings from companies, for example, searches from those who are searching jobs. What does that mean? That means that this is the demand. So this is what companies are demanding across time. And this is what we currently have in terms of people who are searching for those jobs. So what does that mean? It means we have a shortage of people to be able to fill the demand that companies are seeking. So it is true that data is getting easier to gather, but making sense of data is still hard, just even amongst ourselves when we do our own data analyses. And I would argue that the way that we do that is completely based on methods. So we teach our students, for example, methods, tools, languages, computation, and these are fundamental components and will always be fundamental components of a data science curriculum. Just to pick on my own department, so for example, we at our department at Hopkins, the biostats department, produced one of the first massive open online courses in data science on the Coursera platform. I'm sure these numbers are out of date. The slide is a little old. But just to state that people are interested in this, and then if you look at what's currently being taught, it's methods and tools and languages. So this is the classic approach that people are putting into their curriculum. However, I'm going to argue that teaching students to be a successful data science requires more in the curriculum than just teaching them the tools, the methods, the languages, and so forth. So I'm going to spend the next few minutes talking about some challenges that I have faced as an educator teaching students not only at Harvard but at Hopkins data science. So one of the first ones that I find to one of the first data science education challenges that I wanted to talk about was teaching students how to actively create and hone a question with data is actually very hard. So Wild and Finuk, they, I believe, define this as statistical thinking. Another one of the people that I admire on Twitter, Nate Silver, he wrote this tweet in October 2019. I'll read it. A few times a year, I get asked to be a judge of student stat projects in politics or sports. And while the students are very bright, they spend way too much time using fancy methods and not enough time framing the right questions and contextualizing their answers. And then he goes on to say, if you want to be a good data scientist, you should spend approximately 49% of your time developing statistical intuition or how to ask good questions of the data, or 49% of your time on domain knowledge, as Bhramar was mentioning, and only 2% on the methods per se. And so this concept of wanting and to make sure we train our students on how to ask these good questions was echoed by Rob this morning, and it was echoed by John this morning as well. So this is a big challenge, and I don't see a lot of curriculum developed around this, and I would love to see that more integrated into data science curriculum. So one of the second challenges I've run into is how to teach students to connect the questions. So once we've thought very carefully about what is the right question to ask, how to connect appropriate data to that question, or how to pick an appropriate method or an algorithm or tool. And the way I like to think about this, so for example, if we think about the methods or the algorithms or languages or tools, I like to think about it as a toolbox. So we are teaching our students all of these very powerful techniques in our data science curricula. And then people like to fill and create different types of toolboxes. So for example, my three-year-old son has this type of toolbox. So it's a very simplistic toolbox, and he can get by and try to screw in a screw as my husband tries to screw in a screw into our wall, for example. But it's very simplistic, but it works. Some people want the more rugged tools, but they want to know that it's simplistic. I have a hammer, I have a screwdriver, I have a Phillips head, I have a flathead, and I have everything I need to be able to get by. Some people want all the things. They want to be able to know all the methods and all the tools, and they want it completely organized. How you approach this is completely up to you, but being able to take what's in your toolbox and figure out of all the things that I know, or maybe I don't know, what is the right tool or method to be able to ask or to address this question, and what are the right data to be able to address this question, I think is not easy for students to grasp, and I would love to be able to see that more connected into curricula. Another challenge I've come across is how to teach students how to design, collect, interpret, and interact with messy data. So for example, in the classroom, we tend to use very clean data sets that fit certain assumptions, and we do this because out of simplicity for whatever we're trying to teach. But in the real world, data are very rarely clean, and the methods and the assumptions of the methods are very rarely met. And so teaching students to be comfortable with that, I think, is really important. And then also to be comfortable with the fact that solutions to problems are open-ended and they're non-trivial. And I find a lot of students panic when they realize there's no right solution. So training them to be in that mindset, I think, is really important. So I've started a website called Open Case Studies, and I'm happy to talk more about that. It's essentially a repository of data analyses that people can use, lecturers can use in the classroom to teach students about real world challenges, teach students the data analytic skills that they need to address real world challenges. Two more. So the fourth challenge is communication, narrative, and storytelling. How do we teach our students to effectively communicate about data and to build a narrative and to tell a story whenever they are talking and building their data analysis? And the fifth one that I'm also interested in is evaluation of data analyses and data science projects. So as an educator, I evaluate students' projects and homework assignments, and I often get the question, what does it mean to have a good data analysis, or what does it mean to have a successful data analysis, or to be valid, or to be complete, or to have an honest data analysis? And so it's important for me to be able to convey to students what I mean by that, because they want to succeed in their own world. And so it's important for me to be able to not only say what I mean, but also to be able to teach others. And I think evaluation is a real problem in our current curricula. You ask people, what does it mean to produce a good data analysis? And you may get comments like, it's hard to put into words, or I know it when I see it. And as someone who has a PhD, I developed that experience by going back and forth with my mentor and my advisor over the course of 5 years. But we can't expect students to do that. And so I think being able to distill down by what we mean as a good data analysis in terms of evaluation is really important. So when we go back to this plot about needing to address the shortage for the data science positions that are in demand, we have to think about scalability. So anything that we do to be able to address these challenges has to be scalable. So if we look at what are some solutions that are currently available for scaling data science education, I mentioned massive open online courses. There is the ability to auto-grade, so be able to produce R notebooks or Python notebooks, and you can auto-grade code chunks based on whether they have the right answer or not. But that doesn't really address evaluation of data analyses as a whole. You can't auto-grade quality of an analysis. And then there's also experiential learning or project-based learning or practicums. And so the question I wanted to ask the panel and the audience is, how do we incorporate all of these open challenges using currently available strategies, or do we need to come up with alternative strategies? And finally, I'll just give a shout out. So if you want to know more of my thoughts about these types of topics, I decided to start a podcast discussing all things data science and academia. It's co-hosted with another faculty member in my department, John Muschelli. And I think that's it.
Thank you very much for thoughtful conversation. Very much. So I have a couple questions. I have some of my own. I'm sure there are audience members. So if you all have questions, please, there are folks walking around with mics. Just please raise your hand, and we will do that. While we wait for that, I'm going to actually ask a bit of one of my own, because I think we're all, I think, struggling between this balance of What do we have to do for accreditation, which I think many of us in many ways struggle with. I think we also are faced with increasing demands among students. I know if I walk down the school halls and when I talk to students and I say, how many of you are interested in data science? Do you think this is important to your career? 75, 80% of them are feeling very much like they need these skills to get a job. Because they go and look at the job ads and they see what's out there and they want to be able to, and those ads are very specific about the data science skill sets that people want, and they often are very complicated and not the simple ones that we think are necessary and foundational, right? So they're in a hurry to get there. So I guess I'd like to ask you, as you each have grappled with this a bit, to talk to us about how do you deal with that? How do we balance and operationalize this when we have various levels, right? We want to and need to train the next level of scientists who are the revolutionaries who are out going to be out in front. I think we all want everyone who enters our schools to have a certain amount of data science literacy, to understand the value of good data, and how do we do that? So you mentioned scalability, Stephanie, in terms of how we scale up to reach large people and large audiences. I think the other thing is, how do we scale up to meet the different needs within our schools and programs? And I'd like to ask you to start there, and then we'll open up to the audience.
Go ahead.
Okay, I can start. So I think part of the issue is actually what I said at the beginning of my opening talk, is the students sometimes, a lot of times actually, are ahead of us, and they redefine what data science should be in the public health context, mm-hmm. and they don't have the right context in terms of the entire competency. So I think as educators, we have to be really preemptive and really define what does data science mean in the public health context, right? And then what kind of skill sets do the students need? I think unless we do that homework ahead of time, then I think we'll just be following potentially misguided cues from our students and from other avenues, and that actually could be a disservice to the field. So I think step number one for me is actually we have to define what we mean as data science in the public health context. And until we do that, I think we'll just be groping in the dark. So I think that's for me step number one in a
Great.
Big way.
Thank you.
So I think I'm going to decompose the question into two parts. One is how to modify the training of the students who are coming into the biostatistics department to make it biostatistics. So the two programs I talked about is mostly biostatistics
right.
and combination of data science. But I think overall, public health, I think we have not done a very good job in co-teaching courses where data science is coupled with environmental health, data science is coupled with epidemiology. So I just finished teaching a course with an epidemiology professor where there was a module, three modules in machine learning, causal inference, and mediation analysis, where there is a epidemiologic study that this investigator leads, and there are scientific questions, and students learned from each module and applied to that study with a scientific question, and we co-taught from epidemiologic perspective and biostatistics perspective. So I think in order to really infiltrate each of the disciplines in public health with data science, we need this intersectional teaching and intersectional courses where the domain science comes in, but then there is rigorous principle data science expertise, which is not just learning how to apply the black boxes, but to get the fundamental epistemic sort of understanding of why this is so.
Great, thank you. Yeah,
yeah.
Stephanie,
yeah. No, that was good.
Okay. I know we have a question, yes, please.
I think it was already on.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Katie Betancourt. Unlike most of you, I actually am not in academia. I work for Janssen, which is the pharmaceutical division of Johnson & Johnson and the R&D data sciences group. So coming from not education, though I do have a PhD, sort of point of view. I wanted to, one, say, Stephanie, right on in everything you're saying. Our group specifically views data science, and I could get into the argument about what it is, but I won't, as two kind of components. There's an analyst side of things that's really based in the technical skill set, and you're talking a lot more about the algorithms and being able to apply them and all of that. But then we have a scientist track, and these are actually hiring, we hire primarily PhDs from straight from academia and different avenues, because what we know is that what you're talking about, what you learn in a PhD program, that how to think about the question, how to ask the right question, how to interpret the results is the number one thing we can really add. And all of the techniques are learnable. And the rate computer science changes, you won't know it anyways in a year or two, and you'd have to learn it anyways. So it's a huge thing for us. And when we go look for hiring, we are looking at who can think scientifically about this and has some background in those core things. So when you're developing a program, I want to challenge you to really think about it in two different ways, thinking about creating the technologist, creating the analyst, the people who are really the core computer science people, and giving them some statistics background, because I think they do need that. But then also thinking on a higher level, and I think it's more about incorporating the techniques in the training that you're doing with your PhDs, and then really helping them to learn that they can be data scientists if they want, just because they got a biostatistician's degree or they got a chemistry degree. If they were doing the techniques and the concepts, they can be data scientists. What I sort of have for a question for you guys is sort of how, on the other side, from the hiring point of view, from the company side, how can we work with you to help get at the talent that you're developing and help them understand that they could fit these data science roles that were that are being posted, even though they read these complicated, and I know we write them too, job postings, and they say data scientist, and you're like, well, I'm not a data scientist. What can we do to reach out and to really help facilitate the transition from where you are now into the data science actual careers?
An answer for that.
So practicums and course-based external practicums where students can go into companies seems like it's been very successful. So Hopkins hasn't done that ourselves in our PhD program, but based on other people that I know who've done very well at that, like Rebecca Nugent at CMU, for example, other faculty that I'm aware of, that seems to be a very fruitful way for students to be able to get exposed to both how they're using the methods in practice, but also experience practicing some of the skills that I talked about in a real world setting. So being able to have close partners between academia and industry, I think, is a very strong thing, and allowing students to come into your workplace and help answer some of your questions.
Kind of two-part answer. I think the first one is, as program developers, when there are new degree programs being developed or existing programs are being enhanced, I think it's up to us to actually, you know, it's a responsibility to do some sort of kind of market analysis, reach out to the end users like you, and try to really find out what the skill sets needed are. The other thing is, as you know, Stephanie said, to build in practicums and other internship kind of settings into the training program. The MS program that I told you about in health data science at USC, a number of units are actually dedicated to a practicum. There is no thesis for this course, but there is a practicum, and that's designed for the students to actually go out into the workforce and find out how they can apply their skill sets. But in all this, the challenge is actually that the face of the field is evolving, and it's in a very dynamic state. So the programs themselves also have to be dynamic, have to be ready to change with the times, because it's not a static, you know, kind of setting. You know, things are changing very fast, right? So that has to be kept in mind in all these scenarios.
I will also say that, I like how you approach the hiring of these more analytic people and these people who answer the higher level questions. I didn't mean to downplay at all the discussion about the importance of teaching students methods. It's just I felt like a lot of that was already going to be discussed here, and so these are important components of a data science curriculum that are not going away. I just feel like there's a little bit more to it to be able to be successful in your research or in industry whenever you go to holistically look at the problem, not just the methods individually.
So partnership, I think, is something yes. that we take away. I think we need to partner with you all and with the sector from between the academic institutions in terms of being able to give students opportunities to actually have those experiences while they're in training, so they bring them back to us. And I think also as we design curriculum for your input. I'm going to take a question here and then come back over there if I could. So bear with me. But I think one of the this Your question leads us to an interesting one that came, and I think it's interesting and many of us talk about it. So we've all acknowledged that many more students, particularly out of biostatistics, and are going into the private sector and going into jobs like Google and Facebook and other things. And you know, I think one of the questions that's come from the audience is, you know, what do we need to change, or do we need to change something to keep them in public health? Or is this an okay outcome for schools and programs of public health to be training people both for the field and for other sectors and other fields? And so I came from our audience, but I would add that into the conversation here.
Salary.
Yeah, salary is a big one, right?
So I think, you know, it's becoming very hard to retain very strong graduates into public health and biostatistics and in academia in particular because of these alternative jobs. And the demand for our students mostly used to be in pharmaceuticals and health sector and research sector. Now all of these jobs have opened up, which are intellectually extremely exciting. Mm-hmm. There are very good benefits and in terms of flexibility and great projects. And so it's becoming increasingly hard to retain students. And I think it's good that they are going with this rigorous training. They are going to Google and Amazon and Facebook and Flatiron and changing the culture there. But at the same time, one of my students just wrote that just by parallelizing logistic regression, I'm making more money than you. How does it make you feel? So honestly, I think we have to be competitive. We have to sort of bring in what we do, what we really love to do, and also the next training, the next generation, the education piece, and this volatility that, like, you know, things are going through change and not status quo can be played to our advantage, that this is an exciting time to shape curriculum, to change. But I think it's becoming increasingly hard in order to do so, yeah.
I think a part of the downside of actually statistics and data science becoming sexy, even though I think now we can talk at dinner parties about our field, the downside has been actually we are losing a lot of people to industry because they're very popular. So I think it really comes down to money, I guess, and also the opportunity to make, you know, the experience rewarding, you know, to someone who could go otherwise, you know, to a private sector and earn more money.
So I wouldn't necessarily say it's all money. I would also say, for example, somebody who might consider an applied position for doing data science research in academia versus an industry, they might question, will I be supported as a junior faculty member, money aside, will I be supported as a junior faculty member to do applied research that's solving important public health problems, or should I go in industry and just focus on the problems when I'm going to be told I need to publish more and I need to do more of a certain type of scholarship? So, I mean, somebody may say that they may weigh that balance. So I would love to see people who are sort of bridging that divide come into academia, because that tells me that they have the training to be able to do really good data science. And those are the people that we really want teaching our students, who are close to doing data science themselves, teaching our students about analyzing data. And instead, they're just going into industry because they may not feel like they would be supported as a junior faculty.
Very important.
All right. So I think, yeah, we have two questions, but just to add a comment, I don't think it's as, I think salaries is a piece. I don't think it's as simple. I mean, I think all of us engage with students who come into schools and programs of public health because they're very dedicated to the mission of solving problems and reducing health disparity and solving inequity. And I think we need to show them that there are pathways by which they can combine these exciting skill sets and contribute to good. And when we do that, I think we're often successful. So, I'm gonna, yes. And then, okay. He had the mic first.
All right.
Okay.
I'm Sudesh Srivastav. I'm a professor in the Department of Biostatistics and Data Science at Tulane University. My question, I won't say is a question, is more a comment. Particularly, we should make sure the statistics and data science, the statistics is more model to data. Like we model them and then we collect the data, the statistics. And the data science is more like a data to model. So these are the two things I take it very, in that way I take it, these two terms, statistics and data science. And so, and whenever, so it reminds me of the R.A. Fisher's old saying. He says, when the data comes to you, basically we are trying to do a postmortem of the data. And so when you are doing a postmortem, you're trying to just answer the question, not you to fix the hypothesis and get the answer of that question. Also, you stress on the points which, because of what reason your data fails to answer that questions. So we should be focusing on that aspects too whenever we are trying to implement or bringing any component in the program or in the training, okay?
We have a mic over here.
Denise Hines, Oregon State University. I am one of those people that fall into the domain knowledge category. So I'm pleased to be in the room where it's happening. But my question is, for programs that might be addressing more of a domain knowledge emphasis, and wants to enhance data science, what kind of advice would you have?
I mean, it's the kind of thing that, you know, Bhramar was talking about in terms of really focused, you know, training in domain areas, but in a way that actually benefits, you know, the domain context is very important. That's why, you know, the educational program, to me, is a spectrum, right? There is a hardcore skills, you know, focused, you know, kind of parallel to what happens in typical data science, biostatistics or statistics departments. That's going to be the bulk of it. But then you will have actually needs that are very specific to domain areas, right? So you really have to work in partnership with a domain context scientist to develop those kind of courses and make them available in the right context. So I think you have to do all of it, actually. It's not really one size fits all kind of approach. It has to be all of the above, I guess. So I think, you know, for any given domain, there are certain flavors of data science that will be more appropriate than others. So identifying those and focusing the training towards those, either within the context of the domain context course or a data science course that's designed for that kind of domain context would be appropriate in that setting.
Or do we build a data science frame into many of our existing
exactly
courses?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Just to provide some more specificity, I would maybe, let's just say it's nursing, just hypothetically. So I would build a set of case studies or lectures around some standard types of data or problems that that domain faces. So you could do this by going to researchers or people who work in the area to figure out what are some standard things that you constantly want to teach students about, and then build lectures where you always start with the problem that's domain specific. So you're always framing your data analytic lecture around the context that you're interested in, but then teaching the students to those data analytic skills to be able to address that domain specific context question. I would build a set of domain specific courses, which I think is what you were describing, based on some kind of case study, if that makes sense.
So I completely agree. I think we have done a very good job in establishing research partnership with the different departments and in terms of colleagues in a different departments in public health as well as in College of Medicine and throughout campus. But I think we have not really collaborated so much with in terms of the education space, different disciplines coming together with some core values, but then distinct skill sets to teach the students that, yes, you may not understand all the intricacies of lasso or post-model selection inference, but you still know this problem you should use. You should not stop at stepwise regression. You should do something differently. And I think with the modern softwares and skill sets, it's eminently possible. The Gen Z was born with, like, you know, iPad in their hand, and so they're not afraid. And so as we are teaching the next generation of students, I think we need to keep in mind the summer program students who come, even students from a non-quantitative background, they're fearless. They will, like, you know, they crash our servers like once every week, but they're just like daunting, like you. So I think that we need to understand the students that we are teaching and then really focus what they're interested in and how to support them with a quantitative line of query with a substantive question of interest.
And I know we have a question. I'm just going to add a comment if I could. But I think we talked about this in the earlier session in terms of promotion and tenure. Like, do the academic structures that we have support this interdisciplinary approach to education? And I would argue in many cases it doesn't. And we've been looking at, what does it mean to have school-wide courses where people come together and collaborate? So I think that's another thing we have to grapple with.
So John Quackenbush from Harvard School of Public Health. I want to share with you an existential crisis. And this is sort of like Stephanie's question about, how you mentor junior faculty. So I don't know how other people pay for their PhD programs, but ours are largely paid for through NIH training grants, T32s. And we're always worried about getting T32s. We're under increasing pressure to provide documentation that our students who are trained in T32s are continuing along academic research careers. As more and more students choose to go into industry, we're really starting to worry that we're not going to be able to maintain our funding to continue training students. So I'm just curious if any of you have come to grips with this yet, and what are you thinking of as solutions? Because I don't think we have a good one yet.
So I'm a junior faculty, so I haven't had to grapple with writing T32 yet.
Don't ever do it.
But I mean, I would think about trying to change the academic model such that those individuals who maybe sit on the boundary between academia and industry, being able to encourage them and say there is a place for you here that they may not have considered before, but that requires changing the system. Bhramar mentioned burning it down. I'm not necessarily advocating for that, but modifications need to be made to be able to support these individuals. And in that way, these individuals who are very data analytics savvy or data savvy can not only teach our students what they know, they're like one of the best set of individuals to be able to teach those students, but then we also retain that talent in academia. I mean, there's a lot of benefit to that. So that's my take on it.
I'll comment about the training grant piece, because I led training grants for almost 15 years, is there has been a trend where more of the students are going that way, but every university is seeing that, right? And so I think it's part of the narrative is that we're training leaders in the field, and they are shifting in where they're going now. And I mean, it's not like some universities only putting people in academia. So I think it's just the changing reality and making sure that we value those different directions they go, whether it be a government position or in an industry. But it also means that NIH at a higher level has to think we're okay with people not only being academics, right? Because we know that that pool is continuing to shrink, so it's been difficult. So I see Lauren with the hand there.
Oh, hi, this is Konstantin Yonitsis from Indiana University. So thanks for that slide about the shrinkage with the domain expertise and the methods and so on. And my question is, and it's to all of you, not just the panelists, is I feel that I'm in a school of public health. We have a health data science undergraduate program, and I think we're doing a decent job on the statistics shrinkage part, and I think we may even be doing a decent job on the domain expertise. The part that structurally I'm struggling with is how much of the hacking part should a department or a school of public health pull in-house, and how much of that should we rely on a computer science department or a school of informatics or something? Because I feel that these guys provide general tools, but they don't make necessarily the connection, especially with health. And at the same time, I see that there isn't really a path to promotion to pull in faculty that will teach the hacking skills. And unless these guys are hackers already and crash our servers weekly, but if they're not, we have a problem in terms of connecting the hacking or computer science skills with the domain expertise and the statistics, I find. So I don't know, it's an open question to anyone that might help me fix my problem.
I mean, in the current state where the skills are sitting, right, until, data science and biostat and stat programs actually really embrace, the hardcore computer science type of skills into their domain, right? Then to me, actually, the right way to go would be if, you know, all parties are willing and able to really partner, right? So I think the hardcore skills, as you know, once we define what the competencies needed are for public health type data science, I think partnering with computer science departments to have those available, probably maybe it's the only way to go, except for very few departments, right? But as time goes on, I think my guess is actually these fields will kind of not really blend, but probably, you know, change their form just as a natural extension of the synergy. And then, you know, the kind of skills that you're talking about may become available in, you know, traditional biostat and stat and data science programs, provided that, you know, we make the right hires, provided that we make the right adjustments to our promotion processes and everything so that we actually value those kind of, you know, contributions. Then I think, you know, how it will look like in 5 or 10 years from now, you know, are for grabs, you know, it's, you know, very hard to guess, but my guess is I think those skill sets will be available within the departments that we reside in a public health setting, for instance. And then we don't have to, maybe we don't have to partner, but I think the partnership actually is of value. And I don't think we should shy away from it as long as it makes sense for everyone.
Go ahead, Mark.
So I think that in the health data science concentration that we launched, our faculty have strong expertise. So we do have biostatistics faculty who are really interested in computing, who are really interested in visualization, and also who have special, you know, we have embedded case studies in the different data types we see mostly in public health in terms of genetics and genomics, electronic health records and medical claims, imaging, and wearable devices. These are the four data types we are seeing most often where the computer science and the data processing and the data wrangling, data provenance skills are really integrated very specific to the data type. So that's why somebody just from a general computing background cannot really teach this as well as somebody who is really deeply immersed into solving problems there. So I think it is important to have some in-house capabilities in those realms as well. And for a community to reward those skill sets that we do, the different kinds of skills that they bring to the school and to the department.
I'm going to bring in a comment and then we'll go. I know we have some questions, but I want to bring in a question that's come up here that I think ties to this a bit, which is, you know, perhaps in our revolution, we need to think beyond just degree-seeking programs, but other kinds of short courses or boot camps where we bring in these skill sets, but they're not taught outside the context of our larger public health context of education and expertise. And so one of the questions that's come from the audience is, you know, a comment from you all about how we utilize perhaps boot camps or short courses effectively and perhaps partnering with CompSci and stats who have other skills that are outside might be one way to accomplish that, but I wanted to pose the question since it was asked from the audience. Other thoughts on that?
So is the question that would be required part of the curriculum or training, or?
I think it's more, is this something we should be thinking about for the future training of our students in terms
non-degree of- Non-degree programs, but yeah.
Yeah, or even, right, just being able to, again, not everything needs to be taught in a traditional 3-credit course towards an MPH or an MS. You know, how do we stay relevant? How do we prepare people in the context of public health, but partnering with others? So just what your thoughts, some of you have had experience in these boot camps or short courses, and what are some of the challenges of that, or where are those opportunities valuable for other schools and programs to learn from?
In my own data science course that I teach at Hopkins, I can't possibly cover all the topics that I want to cover. So for example, if I can't discuss something like sentiment analysis or the analysis of sentiments with text data, I can assign a particular type of module from Coursera or an online curricula such that the student can go and learn more about that. And I have found those to be very fruitful. I don't use boot camps, or I haven't encouraged students to sign up for boot camps, but being able to have a large body of online material that other people have spent an enormous amount of time and energy developing, I can point to students to certain topics that they can go and gain more expertise in certain areas. That has been really useful.
So there are a couple of examples that I can actually cite. I think it's a very good idea in the context, especially when certain skill sets are needed in domain context. Instead of thinking of full-blown courses, maybe think in terms of boot camps. I think I don't see Andrea Baccarelli anymore in the room, but there is actually the SHARP program, you know, in environmental health sciences that focuses on environmental health issues. But there are a number of courses now. I think for the first time, actually, there is a real partnership between biostatistics and environmental health to introduce a number of courses that are quantitatively oriented. That could be one setting as an example, as a model that actually could be used to have data science, you know, competencies that would come from a biostat kind of faculty or a computer science faculty, but in the context of what the students need. So the other example is at USC when I was there, in the summertime, there is actually a series of boot camps that were provided to students to make sure that they actually have the right computing skills. And they are very, very deep and short but intense, but they are very focused. And their face and nature could change from year to year depending on the need. So there are many mechanisms for, you know, making that available. It could be an alternative, a viable alternative to full degree programs, actually. So I think it's a good idea. Yeah.
I know we had a question in the middle there, and then Jeff over here. Yes.
So I'm Nicole Carlson. I'm in biostatistics and informatics at the University of Colorado. I have a question, but I have a comment on the short courses. We've leveraged our CTSA, and they have the BIRD program, which is Biostats Epi Research Design, and we do a set of six-week in person, but we added intro to data science literacy, and we had, you know, immediately 30 people signing up because we really want to create conversation, and we have to be able to speak the same language. So those year after year continue to get 20 to 30 people in them, so that's a way to leverage other infrastructure that might be at your institution. My comment was, we've talked a lot about PhDs and faculty tracks and keeping them in academics. What about other non-tenure track and our master's core? Because when I work on problems that use data science, I really do need a whole team, and I worry tremendously about our ability to either grow or keep a pyramid, so it's not the PhDs having to do all of the work. So do you have tracks that you'd be willing to share, or thoughts you have about how to retain all levels and give career paths to people outside of the traditional tenure track lines?
That over to the...
So in Michigan, we have the research track, and also in terms of our education space, I think that our education space is also undergoing a lot of change with online education. So we just launched our online MPH, so there is a lot of teaching effort going into the online MPH as well. So we now have a clinical educator track as well. So we have people who are really committed to teaching, modern ways of teaching and pedagogy, so there is a track for that. Research, people who really want collaboration and making a difference in terms of team science and not just lead methodology, so there is a track for that. And then there is a tenure track. So this is a very interesting and important question, how we create a culture where all the tracks have equal respect and think that we are equally valued. A department or a school or a community or a profession is not run by just one kind of people. It's you need all different skills and strengths and talents in order to, but how do you recognize, how do you make your reward system, how do you change the culture of your department so that everybody has voting rights, everybody so treated equally. So that's something we really need to, we are working really hard at that, at a school level as well as a department level, because this is really, really important to appreciate and value good teaching, good collaboration, and good independent biostatistical methodology research. So
I completely agree with that, but I think you had a second part to your question, I guess, where a master's level, you know, statisticians or data scientists, you know, how we keep them in the workforce. Did I misunderstand that, or that was,
yeah.
Right.
Right.
Right. Yeah. So they actually face the same challenge, because those people could actually go out and really make tons of money. And, you know, it's even more challenging in that setting because they don't see, you know, a path towards promotion to becoming tenured or in a non-tenured track be rewarded. So I think, you know, first of all, I think pay them enough to the extent possible to keep them. rewards them not only monetarily, but also giving them credit in the research output, but also maybe encourage them to pursue higher studies so that, you know, they become the next generation of leaders with a lot of experience. So it's always going to be a challenge to retain in the job market where, you know, people are willing to pay them 2-3 times what he can afford, right? But at least, you know, creating a career path and a reward system that actually values their contribution and makes them grow professionally would be the way to go, probably.
Jeff Goldsmith, Columbia Biostatistics. I'm going to apologize, but go back a couple of topics and think a little bit about computer science training. I think everybody mentioned the need for computer science training as an element of data science. And I wanted to ask to be a little bit more clear about what you mean by computer science, because that could be computer architecture and sorting algorithms in C++, or it could be the programming skills that you need to implement an analysis. And I'm wondering what you think is, like, when you say we need computer science education, what really you're referring to, and does that change at the MPH level versus the master's level versus the PhD level?
So I can go first at this, because for the last 2 years with this health data science concentration, we have been really deeply embedded in this discussion. So what we finally agreed on is that, because, you know, in a master's program, you obviously want to retain the basic foundational statistical inference, and then what do you cut down on and what is really essential for. So what we agreed upon ultimately is programming courses, and we have modular courses in Python, C, and R. And then algorithmic courses to understand properties of algorithms as well as optimization. And then computing with big data, which includes visualization as well as distributed computing and large-scale optimization, but with algorithms. And then machine learning, and then more going into statistical issues like multiple testing, variable selection. That's like, you know, that's big challenges, statistical challenges in big data. But in terms of computer science, it is algorithms, machine learning, and R's interface with big data, and so Hadoop, MapReduce, how to implement them. So this is a 4-course sequence.
I would second everything she says, except I would maybe put it at the end of, or allow a student to tailor his or her own curriculum to the degree or weight of computer science that he or she wants. Build a program that's flexible enough to let somebody to take more or less algorithmic versus interacting with large databases. So I think forcing everybody who goes through a program to have the exact same training is easy, but it's not necessarily the case that the two students who are going through the program at the same time are necessarily going to use them in the same way. So allowing them to tailor a little bit of the degree or the weight of computer science, I think, is really important.
So in terms of our experience when we were developing the program at ESC, and probably Meredith could say more a little bit on this, from the computer science core curriculum, we identified at least 3 areas: informatics in large data environments, database systems, and algorithms, as Bhramar said. So those could actually be, at this point in time, well taken from the computer science department. But those are kind of the skill sets that would be needed. We actually decided the machine learning courses to be given within our own unit, simply because you have to tie it into biomedical and public health kind of context. And there were actually people that could do that. So I think, you know, that could be done in a computer science environment, but it could be done in-house as well, provided that you have the skill sets needed.
So we are teaching everything in-house, because we do have people with computer science PhDs in our department who are biostatistics faculty.
And then finally, actually allowing for enough electives to actually create a little bit more of freedom so that people can tailor their own, you know, training, you know, to where they want to go is actually very important.
I think we had a question in the way back.
Hi, Jon Stinkrumston, Brown University. We speak a lot about what to add to the curriculum, but I think a question we often avoid is what to remove. And I think that's even a more important question almost. So I'm interested in getting your thoughts on sort of out of these standard things that we introduce in a curriculum, what would you remove or at least reduce the importance of?
That's interesting. I was at an education conference within the mathematics community recently talking about data science. They were wanting to know how can mathematics become more involved in data science. And that similar question came up of what to remove from the curriculum. And it was brought up several times that we don't necessarily, at the undergraduate level, we don't necessarily need students to go through Calc 1, Calc 2, Calc 3, then linear algebra, and then dive into these courses. We could, for example, build a linear algebra course or a statistics course that's not necessarily based on distributions and allow them to dive into these data-driven courses earlier. So I think there are a variety of things that you could remove, but it requires modifying the current curriculum to be adaptive towards that. And it also requires buying into, like when we were talking about the math education conference, removing the sequences Calc 1, Calc 2, Calc 3, there was a lot of shock in the room. people suddenly felt very panicked. And I think it just, we come at it from a perspective of wanting to let students dive into interesting questions with data as early as possible.
I mean, another way of looking at it is actually, let's say, think of a PhD program or a master's program. A lot of programs actually have tracks within the degree programs, right? You could go to general theory, or you could go to environmental statistics, you can go to clinical trials, statistical genetics. You can think of data science as one track, you know, even though it's kind of a misnomer in a way because it's a little bit more complicated than that. If you think of it that way, then the core competency that everyone needs to get, everyone needs to understand probability at a certain level, you know, solid, you know, foundation on inference, solid foundation on modeling. I think that, you know, probably could be something that could be shared across all tracks. And then people branch out and go their own way, and that's actually where you would like to structure what a data science track would look like if it was to go that way. So that's another way of structuring it. It's not really removing, but tailoring, but giving a common core that everyone needs to get to be called a statistician or biostatistician or a data scientist.
Right, and I would add, because I think at ASPPH meetings, many of my colleagues, when we talk about the education, there's a lot of things we're trying to do, right? We're trying to meet accreditation standards. We want our students to think more critically. We want them to communicate more effectively. We want them to understand climate change and its impact on health. We want them to understand the impact of aging populations and how that's going to impact them. And I think one of the things that I'm hearing you all say and kind of this tension between domain is we need to step back and incorporate some of this thinking, the good data, what's the value of good data, what's the ethics of asking the right questions and into everything that we teach so that we're not just continually siloing and adding on. We need more tracks and more concentrations. Obviously, for those people who are going to do a very deep dive and need very specific skills, that's a different thing. But I think the other question is, for those of us who are looking at a broad curriculum for our MPH students, you know, how do we bring this data science perspective into solving some of the many problems that are relevant for all of our students to think about? So
I think the question of dropping is very important, very dear to my heart, because I have realized that when you talk about adding things, faculty meetings end on time. But when you talk about dropping things, like then you actually argue that, yes, longitudinal data is absolutely necessary for a master's in biostatistics. Someone cannot graduate without survival analysis. So it actually ends to get into the 7 p.m. realm. So we have actually not made longitudinal and correlated data a requirement. It can still be an optional elective for the health data science concentration. And there's a lot of trepidation about running 2 degrees in MS in biostatistics and MS in health data science. And there is fear that most people will go to the health mm-hmm. data science and the traditional classes will not be subscribed. So it's a concentration within everybody gets their master's in biostatistics, but their health data science is a sub plan. And we have really focused a lot on modular courses. Yes, we need want you to learn longitudinal data, but do you need a whole semester of it? But can you have 4 or 5 weeks of longitudinal spatial correlated data, and you can just take 1 credit of that? So we have really compromised a bit on that. And I think what is really important for, and our students have consistently given us this feedback in health data science and biostatistics, is really realistic case studies where you can immerse, because nothing in the textbook realm that you can teach actually translates to their job for job work and real work. So how to really bring in a lot of complex case studies. And that's where actually our domain knowledge partners throughout the campus has been really, really supportive. They have come to us with data sets that they want 40 students to analyze because they don't have funding. And so to do so, and so it has been really brilliant that these new data sets, which nobody have analyze looking at the lens of this data and use for classes for the health data science concentration. So I think that's where partnership comes in as well.
Mm-hmm. And perhaps partnership with industry for interesting case studies. I think we have time for one last question there.
Hi, I'm John Ezra, and I'm a data scientist at Aetna. I did my MPH here at Mailman 10 years ago in health policy and management, and I studied effectiveness and outcomes research. I took a lot of biostatistics courses, and it really helped me get a job in outcomes research and now as a data scientist. I'm really happy to see that, you know, there's a lot of programs, and when we hire students, we look at people who have MS in health data science. But what I was wondering is, you know, one of the challenges I'm hearing is that, you know, you're not up to date. You know, students are telling you that you need to know this. And oftentimes when I come back here and students ask me, oh, should I learn R or should I learn Python? As soon as I give that answer, the next time I come back, I give a different answer because, you know, it's already been changing. And I was wondering if maybe there could be more of like a seminar or something like, you know, where, you know, how they teach entrepreneurship at Stanford, they invite VCs or founders, and I was wondering if you can also do that. You invite practitioners who are data scientists, because we have new types of positions every day. Like, we have data product manager. What does that mean? You know, we're building software products, and just for students to get a feel, like for teachers, professors to learn, but also students to learn, and also myself to keep updated.
That's a great point, and I think it speaks a little bit to some of the how fast this field is moving. Yeah. Does talk about the value of short courses or boot camps to kind of immerse and bring people in from outside and industry and other places that would allow us to do that. So I'm going to turn to endless other comments to that.
No, it's fine.
Okay. So we have several questions that we haven't gotten to from here, but I think given the I've seen the capacity of this panel, so I'm going to challenge you. And one of the things that has come through in some of these questions is asking about some bold predictions for the future. And and I would ask you to kind of keep those to public health education and sort of, you know, we all are in a very changing environment. Where do you see the educational initiatives around data science? And I would say not just for those who are going to have PhDs in biostatistics or data science, but for all of those who enter the field in public health, what might be a bold prediction you're willing to throw out there in front of a few people, and we won't hold you accountable.
Initiatives? Like what? Okay, maybe you guys go first.
or what you think, you know, what the context might look like in schools and programs of public health. I mean, will we have a revolution? Will we get rid of departments?
I mean, it's very hard to predict, you know,
yes,
what it's going to be like. And we have heard that many times today. And education especially is actually a long-term investment, right? So you have to think 5-6 years down, you know, ahead of time to really imagine what the field will look like 4 years down the road. Because you start a curriculum now, you're training a student for 4 years. By the time they go out, what they learn probably could be obsolete. So in the educational realm, you really have to think ahead. It's even more challenging than the research side, actually. So I think, you know, staying alert and really the foundational core, in my opinion, is not going to change. So I think really having, you know, a core, you know, strong core in that, in the training, is very important. And then you really stay dynamic and, you know, have a curriculum review dynamically so that, you know, you're up to date. So the challenge is going to be there. And in terms of what it will look like 5 or 10 years down the road, I don't know. I think, you know, I think there will be more fusion. There will be more of coming together. And what we know as a data science and whatever we call it may change completely in 5 or 10 years down the road. But my guess is I think there will be more interdisciplinary science. There will be more crosstalk, hopefully, between computer scientists and statisticians and biostatisticians. And I think, you know, the kind of inferential topics that we have to concentrate on or to focus on probably will be changing. So if we are dealing with, you know, the entire population of US, you know, data being available, are we really going to talk about or worry about, you know, sample size calculation? probably we should worry more about the bias and whether we're actually targeting the right estimation, right? But, you know, there are also examples where you have, you know, kind of the wide, you know, version of the big data where you still have very few subjects, and but you're collecting tremendous amount of, you know, information on each one of them, then the challenge really becomes a challenge of scale. So I think the data availability issue is going to really challenge us, keep challenging us, because data will be cheaper and cheaper to collect. And the challenge for statisticians and data scientists is to make sure that we don't really grow information, but at the expense of the signal, right? So, you know, that's actually where the design aspect comes, you know, in. And that's not gonna change. So our training has to incorporate, you know, good knowledge of the trainees in terms of how to design good studies, even in the presence of ability to collect data very cheaply. So I think there are certain things that are not going to change, but many things, you know, probably will change, you know, in directions that we cannot even imagine right now. So it's very hard to predict, I guess, you know.
You called for revolution.
Yes, I call for revolution. I might get fired when I go back. But I do think that I think I want to sort of, this is, you know, we can dream, because this is something that we do not have to hold ourselves accountable that we are going to be penalized. So I think that this evaluation system of our admission, our moving on to the PhD, so this obsession on scores, these GRE and qualifiers and these things, I believe that this is actually going a little bit dying down, this obsession, and that's a good thing. And test our students more on epistemic understanding and foundational understanding of this. I think this is something probably we're all trying to enforce in our courses. And really, innovation and independence, and whether you can actually solve a problem and communicate and narrate the story, I think that's going to be becoming increasingly important. I do think that reproducibility, scientific rigor, and open science, people will be more mindful across the field of public health. More hands-on analysis, where there is no prescribed answer and you really try to solve a problem, I think is going to be increasingly important as well. And I do think that we should really experiment. We have sort of played it safe, and I just think that we should take more risks. And getting always in the University of Michigan, getting strong students and getting stronger, why don't we take a little bit weaker students from those benchmarks and see, like, you know, where the education can be more differential. And as a field, I feel inclusive excellence and reducing disparities across the world, I think, should become more important regardless of which department of public health you are in.
Excellent.
I think the field of data science and public health is bright. The future of data science, public health is bright. I think in my own training in the world of applied statistics and biostatistics, we have made great contributions to solving really important problems that help people analyze their data in really transformative ways. And I look at the problems that are around me today, and I just see such excitement in the students and the faculty who are committed to solving these important public health challenges. So from my perspective, I have a lot of hope and good feelings about the future. I do think that the system, the academic system that's in place, will probably have to adapt to be able to embrace a little different types of scholarship, for example, and I think that will happen. And I think students will continue to see the value in wanting to work on these public health challenges as we bring them into our classroom and we show them the value and the impact that they can have by learning these data analytic skills to solve these really important public health challenges.
Yeah, I would agree. I would say that the future, I would agree that we have a bright future, and I think something you raised about the Gen Z, the students who were born with the iPads, we can harness that energy.
Sure.
Right. Oh, my mic is off?
I
guess that means I'm out of time. but I think we have this power to harness that energy. The students who are very good storytellers, they're creative about using social media, and they're committed to changing the world and these great social issues. anyway, so I think the future is bright. So
if you didn't hear, that was very profound. Sorry.
No, but I think we, you know, I think we have this power to embrace diversity, to harness the energy of these young students who come to us with a great enthusiasm and really good data visualization, ability to tell stories and use technology in ways that disseminate information in ways that are new and different and will become a part of our schools. So thank you all for your bright ideas and engaging conversation. It was a great conversation about education and its future. Thank you for being here with us, and thank you. We have a break, and we will be back at 3:15.